this section, I would like to little more elaborate this applied biology or the aquaculture biotechnology. This is important because in the postgraduate study, maybe in our doctoral studies, as students and the faculties, you know, they should be able to understand such an important streams are available in biology, especially in fisheries and aquaculture, which as far as basic science is concerned, very important. And it directly falls in the gamut of this biotechnology, marine biotechnology, aquaculture biotechnology. Same way, the spin-off can be directly, you know, applied or utilized in developing technologies, which can be drivers for the future development of the aquaculture as such. For example, look here in the aquaculture biotechnology, different areas. See, you can look at the each component in this particular diagram. Population genetics, broodstock development and induced breeding I was mentioning earlier also, larval rearing, live feeds, microbial products and prebiotics and probiotics, immunostimulants, formulated feeds and all farm management, disease management, genetic profile and stock improvement. So, each component itself reflects a very important, almost an important domain of study or knowledge and research or whatever it is, say. So, the opportunities or the aquaculture being, it's only even in the, you can say science or biotechnology, aquaculture biotechnology is just developing. It is in the initial phases. The opportunities for the, in the students or in the faculties or in the, our science HRD is enormous. And I may not be able to look into the details of this thing, but I will just try to touch upon. For example, when in the hatchery, when the fish is bred and when the egg is hatched out into a small larvae, you should imagine the mouth of this larvae is so small, it can only take very small, you know, particle size as the feed. There only this, you know, the whole microalgae, this, what I am showing it is microalgae. It is a whole world of microalgae because the algae, it is something like a plant in the small, it is the size is almost like a micron size in 1/1000th of a millimeter, you know. And this micron size larvae, micron size algae is the feed by the immediately hatched out larvae. So we need to make develop the technologies to produce this microalgae. So this microalgal study is a microalgal biotechnology itself is very big. We have to isolate, we have to cultivate, we have to scale it up and feed the larvae. So I cannot go into the details of it, but again, once you see the microalgae, so that is the one algal stage. Then next stage, the larvae required animal feed. Again, the size is a big challenge. They need something like 100 to above 100, you know, micron size. You can say the 1/5 of the, you know, a millimeter and above. You know, so here you can see there is a species called Artemia. It's a very fantastic species. You know, almost all the shrimp and finfish larvae in marine and brackish water, and this is the live feed being followed by algal feed. And Artemia is very unique in that because the small larvae of the larva size of the Artemia is the right size of this animal. They just started feeding, so the Artemia napoli will be you know, swimming around, and these larvae can just have a dynamic activity of catching and eating, so that the life is going into the different phase. And the Artemia, the whole Artemia cyst, it is into so many you know, millions of dollars is being imported into the country because this is mostly produced in majority by like USA and Russia and some other countries. So, but and this has been produced in the very high saline areas. In India also we have these areas. We may be able to develop and scale up the Artemia culture, Artemia cyst, and this very valuable. It is a kind of complete scientific activity or biotechnology. We need to translate it into a product. And again, spirulina, it is a small algae. It is one of the most rich, you know, in protein, 40% to 50% protein. And now you know that companies like Parry, they are producing the spirulina, making it into a smaller, you know, capsule, and it is available in the market. And this particular thing is from the SIBA. We have a local isolate of spirulina, and we were able to do it in spirulina culture and production. Maybe once we develop into scaling it up, this itself can we can make an our own an industry where the high protein content will be able to incorporate in the formulated feeds, and which can bring the cost down. And again, being a good protein, this can also be used for human consumption. And again, once this live feed part is over, we need formulated feeds. The feed is one of the most important part in rearing. That means the major expenditure is accounted to speed. These fishes are found excellent converting into feed into biomass. That means the conversion efficiency is high in fishes and shrimp when compared to the other like poultry and cattle. And you can see that feed contributes about 30% to 60% of the operational expenditure. Directly affect the growth of the fish, water quality, final product and quality too. Determines the overall sustainability of the industry. That shows that how important is the formulated feed, means artificial feed with right nutrition. It itself is a technology, and nowadays so many overseas companies are the leaders in the production of the formulated feed, and we are major importers. And in India, in the shrimp farming is one of the major sector where formulated feeds are used. Most are multinationals. So it is very important we ourselves should use our own resources and make our own quality formulated feed. In this context is one example, SIBA, we were able to develop a formulated quality feed for the shrimp farming, that is a grout feed, and this feed, the quality is almost equal to the imported feed. So this is shows that how the feed biotechnology, by understanding and knowledge driven initiatives, and finally how we can develop and convert into a product, and this product is really helpful for the farmers in bringing the cost of production down. That means the market, the profitability will increase. And otherwise, if you simply depending upon the imported feed, the multinationals, then they may dictate the price of this the feed. That means when the price of the feed is kept high, the cost of production will go up. That means the profitability of the margin, the profit margin of the farmer will come down. So I am with this example, I am only trying to emphasize that the knowledge in the domain of feed biotechnology, how we can use it for as a, in the first place in the science, then the outcome can be used in the development of the product. Then followed, once the you see the live feed, algae and the Artemia animal live feed, and then you see in the formulated feed, now this is the disease domain. And you can imagine, this is one of the most limiting factor in any rearing system. Let it be agriculture, animal husbandry, or the fisheries. Disease forms one of the most limiting, because once the disease set in, and it is very difficult to control, especially in the aquaculture, because in water, when the disease once it is occur, it is very difficult to control it, unlike in the terrestrial system, because it is in the whole resource. It is that suppose 10% of the farmed species are affected, whether shrimp or fish, you cannot attend the 10% alone in the water. The intervention should be for the 100%, that 90% affected also will be there. It became a huge challenge. That is why we call it is not disease control in aquaculture or in aquaculture fish farming. We call it aquatic animal health management. How to manage the disease, not to set in the disease. Once the disease is set in, it will be very difficult to control. So prevention is better than the cure, the conventional wisdom settled in aquaculture. And when you wanted to manage without disease, you see the old gamut of the components of this particular disease management. Again, each component reflects a complete biotechnological area. You can see that surveillance and reporting, zoning, prebiotic, probiotic, immunostimulants, vaccines, disease resistant varieties, diagnostics, import risk analysis and quarantine, even surveillance and reporting. We just want to monitor whether disease, how you can do it, because you need very novel tools, because even in the very first stages itself, you need able to determine whether the pathogen is coming in. For example, a virus. You can see a virus only through electron microscope. How you can see that? There are novel diagnostic tools we have to develop, and with that non-lethal methods, we can detect the pathogen coming in, or whether building up, and so that we would be able to tackle with intervention. So this aquatic animal health management itself it encompasses, you know, the so-called biotechnological, almost all domain. And each one area is so huge, and it would not be possible for this kind of short lectures to bring down the, but only thing what we require is that to understanding that this much of science is there attached to this aquaculture, related biotechnological aspects. And one example is here, it's a new disease, you know, in when intensification, I was telling about the success story of the Indian shrimp farming. In each stage, you know, more and more disease conditions are coming. It is one new virus has been reported, and it has been, been again recorded in India, in the north east part of the India. So you can see that all basic, biological tools like histology, histopathology, then we will go to the electron microscopy. After the electron microscopy, we know the virus. You can see a PCR gel there where we have used a molecular diagnostic technique to detect the disease. That means here it is in a holistic version. That means all kinds of, from the basic to the advanced technology or even knowledge has been used in identifying and tracking the disease in aquaculture. So even you can say the PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, and real-time PCR detection, not even used in human diagnosis in India, but in aquaculture, for example, in the shrimp farming, use of real-time PCR is a norm. And this is what, when you are using the technique should be very specific, sensitive, and cost effective. Suppose you go to the histology or even electron microscopy, it is not an easy thing, it's not a simple tool, it is labor oriented, it's time consuming. But when you come to this a molecular diagnosis, a DNA based new generation diagnostic tool such as PCR has emerged as the solution of choice for the rapid diagnosis with speed, specificity, and sensitivity. So this shows again that even once a pathogen has come, we need to understand the pathogen, study is involved, advanced level of study. Then once the pathogen is identified, we need to know about it's about the genetic makeup, DNA details. Then only we can develop. It is one of the, this picture shows that when there was an emergence of a virus, it's an RNA virus called white muscle disease. We in Sibha here developed a diagnostics, because that is the thing. Once you have the knowledge base, you have got the expertise, you can immediately go into the next level of finding solutions, and we could able to develop a nested PCR diagnostic kit. That means within 3 to 4 hours, we will be able to diagnose the, and this will be a very good tool for the hatchery owners. And again, next level, now you may be increasingly knowing about the genome and bioinformatics. Human genome has been completely sequenced. Now we can even individually, we can track the genetic map of a human being. And new technology has come. You hear what you're seeing is that at Sibha, we also have to understand this major pathogen like white spot virus I was mentioning earlier, which was a dreaded pathogen in the aquaculture sector, especially in shrimp farming. So we have done all the basic studies. We understood the virus, we have done all other kinds of, finally we want to know the genome. Now we have sequence, we have the full genome of the white spot virus. This knowledge will again will be helpful in tackling this disease. Even now 37% of the crop failure in India, especially in major states like Andhra Pradesh, is due to this virus. So this knowledge, the modern knowledge, I am only trying to emphasize how this emerging knowledge and biotechnological aspects has been directly used in the production of or the aquaculture arena. And this is another, this is also another bacterial pathogen implicated as one of the major problem in the world. And fortunately, this virus was not came to India mainly because we have this knowledge, and we also have a complete genome information sequence, so that we were able to guard the entry of this particular pathogen due to biosecurity and quarantine measures and etc. So this is a very typical example how the biotechnology expertise, we can use it in the in taking this important sector, especially the aquaculture, forward. And when you, any sector, any industry, when it is growing up, mostly intensification happens. That means the farmers and the industry will be tempted to increase the the crop, the outcome. That means the environment will have its own pressure. So this what I have shown is that it is important to make it, do the aquaculture in an environmentally friendly way. That means it should be environmentally compatible without harming the environment. So that there are a lot of models how we can do. This is one model of integrated multi-trophic aquaculture where different species are, you know, reared in different levels of the water, completely utilizing the possibility of the water so that it is sustainable. And then again, the water usage. You know, now we in the hatcheries and all, we are using a lot of water and we have been letting out. Now, new technologies like recirculation system, aquaculture system, it's called RAs. So that what happens that the same water can be recycled and we can use it in a, these are all technologies. And here you can see that biology, engineering and all other aspects is coming and merging. So nowadays, as you know that the science and the border of the science is slowly disappearing. Most of the these are also we should be aware of it because our biological knowledge alone may not be sufficient to develop this kind of system. We need engineering, other aspects and all these integrated thing give solutions in aquaculture thing. So you can see that, you know, crab farming, it may be very simple. What I want to show is that when you think about any product, we need to bring them together. That is the most important. The next domain is one huge area is lying unutilized in India. It is called mariculture. That means farming the fish in the water. Already institution like CMFRA has showed that mariculture, through mariculture also we can increase the production, but we are in the just start. Maybe some bivalve farming, green mussel, etc., some edible oyster, we have done a start. But again, we are and the technologies are also we are, but it is not really come into the like shrimp at technological level. And we are also know how to make value products from the, this is an example that from the green mussel we can produce nutraceuticals, that is useful. And again, like seaweed, we can make it. And you can see the once you have the production like bivalves, you can see the you know the user friendly commodities. We can, you can eat them bivalve, you can wear them, you can even decorate. So these kind of things, that means you can get a multifaceted advantages from them. Then about, then what is mariculture? Mariculture only in the initial stages, and by using the technologies like cage farming, we can able to, you know, you can almost revolutionize the fish production. Another 1 million tons can be produced. Here is a projection. A 100 ton production unit can, a cage maybe support 50 fishermen family and yield an approximate additional income generation of 2.5 lakhs per family through fish farming of say sea bass or a cobia in the marine cages. There's a 1 million ton production system is estimated to support 5 lakh fishermen who are 40% of the active Indian fishermen population. That is almost 1.25 million. The model production projection of 1 million metric tons requires the creation of basic infrastructure such as culture system, fabrication facilities, fin fish hatcheries, formulator feed facilities, each one with 1 million metric ton capacity with a provision of further expansion. Fish assessment networks and again fish processing and preservation networks and upper. So this shows that it's a how huge area of technological opening up, and the it will be required the supporting system, and it will become itself an industry. And so see that what is the resource we have. Yes, preliminary geospatial assessment of Indian economic zone carried out by NIOT reveals the availability of almost 2 lakh kilometers of seawater area excluding the Andaman and Nicobar and the Lakshadweeps. Here the vast sea space technically suitable for sea farming, even 1% of the country, he said, something like 20,000 kilometers where mariculture estates can be established. Considering the huge availability of suitable sea space, 1 million metric ton fish can be targeted. And this can be, say 1 million metric ton is arrived using something like 2,500 kilometer square at a moderate production scale of around 15 kilogram per meter cube by deploying an estimated 67 million cube of cultivable cage volume. So you can imagine, and it is again, it is possible to utilize the 20 to 50 meter depth zone to produce 85% of the present target. That is around 0.85 million metric tons, and the remaining 15% of the 0.15 million metric tons from the nearest zone. This shows that what is the possibilities lying there. We are not even just started, and definitely this using the possibilities of biotechnology and all kind of integration of technology, bringing together and using the vast resources along the Indian coast and including the mariculture. Even the present 1 million tons can be doubled in the maybe another 10 years. So you can imagine what is the prospects lying there for the aquaculture biotechnology, marine biotechnology and fisheries as such in our country. With this, I'm coming to the end of the part, third quarter, and we'll be dealing the last, that is future of futuristic technologies of biotechnology in the next final quarter.